Well, good morning, everybody. As we wait for the procession and the donkey to arrive, let's ourselves begin in prayer. Let's just keep stillness for a moment as we imagine ourselves in Jerusalem, waiting for the arrival of Jesus, the one who will bring blessings to the nation, peace on earth and goodwill towards all. And doesn't our world need that peace at the moment? As we wait in silence, let us remember Jerusalem, the Holy Land, and the Gaza. Let us remember all those longing for peace. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Visit us, Lord, by your Holy Spirit. Together we pray. Father of glory, holy and eternal, look upon us now in power and mercy. Overcome our weakness by your strength. Transform our blindness through your radiance. And in your Spirit, draw us to that love shown and offered to us by your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We're on page 4 of your service books, page 4 of your service books. And we've got the Palm Gospel read for us now. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. The next day, a great crowd that had come to the festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, as it is written, "Do not be afraid, daughter of Zion. Look, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, they remembered that these things had been written of him and had been done to him. This is the gospel of the Lord. And now we wait quietly for the procession to arrive. So we wait in silence until the procession arrives, when I'll ask you all to stand. Please stand. Look how your king comes to you. He is gentle. He is humble. He is riding a donkey. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Humble King, hailed by the crowd as Messiah, grant us the faith to know you and love you, that we may be found beside you on the way of the cross, which is the path of glory. Amen.
The Passion of our Lord, based on the four Gospel accounts.
On the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus saying,
"Where do you want us to make preparation for you to eat the Passover?"
And Jesus said,
"Go into the city, and you will find a man, and say to him, 'The teacher says, my time is near. We will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.'"
So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and it was just as he had said. They went and prepared the Passover meal.
When it was evening, Jesus took his place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said,
"Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me."
And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another,
No, not me! I would never betray you, Jesus! I would never!
I will never betray you, Jesus!
Jesus answered,
"The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me."
Judas, who betrayed him, said,
"Surely not I, Rabbi. Is it I who will betray you?"
"It is you who have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing the bread, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said,
"Eat this, for this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And then he took a cup of wine, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying,
"Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
When the meal was ended, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters because of me this night and run away."
Peter said to him,
"Though all become deserters because of you, I will never desert you."
Jesus said to him,
"Truly, I tell you, this very night before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times.
Peter said to him,
"Even if I must die with you, Jesus, I will never deny you. I could never deny you. Even if all the others were to lose their faith."
No, I would never. I would never deny you, Jesus. I wouldn't.
Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples,
"Stay here while I go over there and pray."
He took with him Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them,
"I am deeply troubled. Remain here and stay awake with me."
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed,
"Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want."
But when Jesus had finished praying, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter,
"So, could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake! Stay awake and pray!"
Again, he went away for the 2nd time and prayed,
"Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done."
Again, he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So, leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the 3rd time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the Son of Man betrayed into the hands of sinners. Look, my betrayer is coming."
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now, the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "At once he came up to Jesus and said, and kissed him. Jesus said to him,
"With a kiss, Judas, with a kiss? Friend, do quickly what you are here to do."
Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
"Put your sword back in its place, for those who live by the sword die by the sword. Do you think I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then will the scriptures be fulfilled? Have you come with swords and clubs to arrest me, as though I were a bandit? Day after day, I sat teaching in the temple, and you did not arrest me."
Then all the disciples deserted him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest. in whose house the scribes and the elders had gathered.
Up and said,
"Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?
Have you no answer to give us?"
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
"I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God."
"Are you the Messiah, the Son of the living God?"
Jesus said to him,
"You have said so. But I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of God and coming on to the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
Blasphemy! You have heard his blasphemy.
We've all heard his blasphemy.
We don't need to call any more witnesses.
Why do we need any more witnesses? We've all heard his blasphemy. What is your verdict?
They answered,
Guilty.
Guilty.
He deserves death.
Death.
The guilty must die.
The guilty must die.
Then they took him and they spat in his face and they struck him, saying, "Prophesy to us, Messiah. Guess who hit you?" Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, and a servant came to him and said,
You were with Jesus. I know you were. I saw you."
But he denied it, saying,
I do not know what you are talking.
And then another servant came and said,
"This man was of Jesus Nazareth. I saw you there. I never forget a face."
Again, he denied it with an oath.
I do not know the man.
After a little while, one of the other bystanders came back again and said to Peter,
"You're one of them. I recognize you."
Then he began to curse and he swore an oath.
He's lying!
At that moment, a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said. Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times. And he went out and wept bitterly. All the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. When Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented, and he brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders and said,
"I have sinned by betraying innocent blood."
But they said,
"What is that to us? See to it yourself. I didn't do it for the money or for you."
"It means nothing to us."
Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed.
"And it is for him! Don't you understand? I did it for him! Jesus! I did it for you!"
And he went and hanged himself.
They bound Jesus and led him away and handed him over to Pilate the governor. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus said,
"You have said so."
"So you are a king then?"
"For this I was born and came into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
"What is truth?"
Pilate said to the chief priests and elders,
"I find no case against him.
He blasphemes.
The people have decided.
He is an enemy of the people.
A dangerous enemy.
Do you not hear how many accusations they bring against you?"
But he gave no answer, not even to a single charge. So the governor was greatly amazed.
"Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to have you crucified or the power to release you?"
"You have no power over me unless it is given to you from above."
Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them,
"Whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus the Messiah?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they'd handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife had sent a word to him.
"Have nothing to do with this man, for I have had a dream about him."
But the chief priests and elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor asked them again,
"Which of the two do you want me to release for you?"
And they shouted,
"Barabbas!"
Pilate said to them,
"Then what shall I do with Jesus who is called the Messiah?"
And all of them said,
"Let him be crucified!"
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
"Let him be crucified!
Do you want me to crucify your king?"
"We have the king of Caesar!
So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, He took some water and he washed his hands before the crowd, saying,
I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourself.
And then the people as a whole answered, so he released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified.
Release Barabbas and have this Jesus flogged. Take him away and crucify your king. The people have decided.
Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a robe on him. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying,
Hail, King of the Jews!
They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe. Then they led him away to crucify him. When they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they crucified him. Over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
You will destroy the temple and build it in 3 days. Save yourself. If you're the Son of God, come down from the cross.
In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying,
He saved others. He cannot save himself. If you are the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, and we will believe you.
He believes in God. Let God deliver him now, for he says, I am the Son of God.
The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. Then Jesus said,
Father, forgive them, They do not know what they are doing. Woman, behold your son. Behold your mother. I thirst.
From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried with a loud voice.
Eli! Eli! Sabachthani! My God! My God! Why have you forsaken me?
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
"This man is calling for Elijah."
Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. It is finished! I'm bleeding. Oh God, I'm bleeding. Oh God, I'm dying.
Oh God, you're
is the gospel of the Lord.
Let's stand and be silent together for a few moments. Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Thank you.
Christ offers himself to us for the life of the world. Jesus, true vine and bread of life, let us share your death and passion. Make us perfect in your love. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is our joy and destiny to praise you, Lord God, for in wondrous love you cast stars into space, and in meek obedience your Son surrendered to cruel nails. With loving kindness you called your people in Abraham, and in covenant with Moses you bound up your life in theirs. Through exile you stayed close to them, and in Jesus you came among them, bearing the fullness of grace and truth. Your Son, Jesus, faced rejection, cruelty, and death, yet in resurrection you exalted him, and in sending your Spirit, you shed glory on all people. And so we rejoice with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, singing the song of your unending praise. Hosanna is our cry, blessed one, your Son comes on a donkey in your name. As Jesus entered Jerusalem to bear our sorrows and suffer for our sins, enter our hearts and confront our waywardness today. Send your Holy Spirit upon us that we may be your Son's crucified and risen body. Send your Spirit upon this bread that it may be living bread, and on this wine that it may be the cup of salvation, that together they may be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who at supper with his disciples took bread, gave you thanks, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Humble God, your Son did not exploit his status, but emptied himself. Pour out your Spirit on all who are exploited in world or church, on all who are humbled by state or employer or family member, on all who are emptied of hope, of faith, or of love. As you highly exalted your Son, who had become a slave, highly exalt your children who suffer for righteousness, or grieve those they have cherished, or bend the knee to one who does not honor them. Fill the earth with your justice and peace until every heart shall sing and every tongue confess that you are the joy of their desiring. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, ever one God, in all ages and forevermore.
Amen.
As our Savior taught us, so we pray, each in our own preferred language. our Father in heaven. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes in glory. Christ took our humanity and blessed it and was broken for us that God's life may be shared. Come, enter the mystery of God's passion for us.
Thank you. Jesus Christ, you humbled yourself in taking the form of a servant and in obedience died on the cross for our salvation. Give us the mind to follow you and to proclaim you as Lord and King, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Oh, that was a lot, wasn't it? If something this morning has stirred up something significant in you and you'd like to talk to somebody about it, if you've got a person or an issue heavy on your heart this morning and you'd like to pray with somebody, there will be people at the altar rail at the end of the service who will be glad to talk with you and pray with you and anoint you on behalf of yourself or another if you'd like that. special welcome to those joining us online. Do stay for online coffee if you're online, and if you're in the building, do make your way down to the parish hall for refreshments. I think I can see some people who could do with some refreshments right now. If you don't know where the parish hall is, somebody very close to you, not necessarily emotionally, but physically right now, will take you by the hand and lead you all the way down to where coffee and other goodies are to be found. Do take note that this evening we have a special Bach cello and poetry evening, the mysteries, poetry and music. You might have a flyer about it possibly with you today. Ruth Padell, the poet, and Adrian Bradbury, the cellist, are going to be playing. It's at 7:00 p.m. I think it's a relatively modest price to help cover costs. Do come along to that. Do stay with the path of the cross through Holy Week, through our last Bread for the World, Good Friday, Lent book conversation on Wednesday night through our 7:00, slightly different time from previous years, 7:00 Maundy Thursday service, foot washing and watch. Also the 10:00 Good Friday all age service, the 12:00, 3 hours. I'll be preaching about what happens on the cross, and the choir, it's always a very special combination of words and music, the 3 hours. If you can come to some or all of it, you can go to the Wintershall Passion in the Square, as featured on Sunday Worship this morning on Radio 4, afterwards, if you'd like to, or you can come downstairs for hot cross buns. And then don't forget the clocks change next weekend, and so the Easter Vigil is especially vigilant at 5:30 a.m., and do stay for breakfast and then the exuberance of Easter Sunday morning in all its glory. We allow ourselves to go all handle on Easter morning. No restraints. So do stay with this program all the way through the week. Now, I think Laura, is Laura here? Is Laura about to spring to her? Yes, she is. Look at this. A miracle is before us. Laura's going to tell you what's going to happen in the Austin Williams at 12:00 today involving her.
Sorry, I slightly forgot that I was doing the announcement. At 12:00 we've got theology group where I'm going to be asking Sam some questions about the Holy Spirit. So yeah, everyone's welcome. Do come along. It's in the Austin Williams room, which is just over there. And I'm sure we'll announce just before from coffee that we're going over there so we can all go together. So yeah, hope to see you there.
Difficult to know how to do this on Palm Sunday, but I think we do all want to show our appreciation to those who performed the drama for us this morning. And don't take this the wrong way, but Jesus, you can come again. We stand for God's blessing. Christ crucified, draw you to himself to find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.